Cardinals. Now the stretch from the belt. Here's the pitch. Line drive, that is! Into left field! Hit number 3,000! A run is scored! Musial around first! On his way to second with a double!
Sandy Koufax, 15 strikeouts in a single World Series game. Trying for number 16 right now against Cash to break the record. He takes his set position, he delivers, here's a pitch, swing and a miss, he did it!
Ruthven checks him. He is going! The pitch is a strike, the throw, he is there!
It's an anniversary celebration. 50 years of Cardinal thrills as the spirit comes alive. Springtime, even throughout the early days, the Cardinal training camp was a kind of place where a little good-natured fun never hurt anybody. The setting may have looked simpler back then, but the sound of the first bat crack and the first ball smacking into leather meant baseball was back for another season. After all, that's what spring training is all about, the hope that all the agony in March will result in a World Series appearance in October. All that pain has to be worth a little pleasure. In the 80s, birds still spread their wings and do those painful things like turn and twist and exercise their wrist, but the season ahead is not to be missed. There would be more fun ahead for the Cardinals as they played King of the Jungle in Los Angeles. Willie McGee directed a power attack that pounded out 17 hits and five Dodger pitchers en route to an 11-7 opening day victory. But anyone who's followed the Cardinals in recent years knows they are not going to win too many games in the power lane. They're much more successful in the suicide lane. Traditionally, the Cardinal brand of baseball has combined a lot of speed, a little bit of ingenuity, and a tradition of spirited hustle.
The Cardinal tradition has always been one where the, you know, blood and sweat has always been your partner of performance. You could not perform with the Cardinals unless you had a dirty uniform. And it is no different nowadays. I think in a sense, when you look at the Cardinals, they play a hard-nosed brand of baseball. Baseball is a war. It's not a game out there. And they let you know right away that it's a war.
Back in 1934, one Cardinal team really did wage all-out war on its opponents. This group of legendary characters included Daffy and Dizzy and Pepper and Ducky. These are the names and faces of a rough and tough group known as the Gas House Gang. This free-spirited bunch will go down in baseball lore as a gang of good old country ball players that played the game like a street fight, scratching and clawing for an edge over their opponent. The Gas House Gang took its cue from player-manager Frankie Frisch, a fierce competitor on the field and a jokester off of it.
I had the good fortune to manage a terrific ball club. They managed themselves, if you know what I mean.
In dramatic fashion, the Gashousers clinched the pennant on the last day of the season before facing the Tigers in the 34 series. It proved to be an interesting matchup, the power-laden Tiger lineup versus the swashbuckling Redbirds, led by the legendary Dizzy Dean. Old Diz was a 30-game winner in 34, but it was a strange incident in the World Series where Dean made his most pronounced headlines.
We beat a great ball club that year, but we had a great ball club. And
you know, it's a funny thing that happened to me in the World Series when I got hit in the head and breaking up a double play. They carried me to the hospital, you know, took x-rays of my head and kept me in the hospital overnight. And the big headlines come out in the paper the next morning. X-rays of Dean's head shows nothing.
In typical Gas House style, Dean came back to shut out the Tigers in Game 7, 11-0, and the underdog Cardinals were champions. Head-first dives, all-out play. That was the Gas House game. Those street-fighting men who started a 50-year Cardinal tradition of playing to a beat all their own and making the opposition play their kind of game. The 34 Gas House gang was honored when the 1944 and 64 championship ball clubs were at a special anniversary celebration at Busch Stadium. From the 64 Miracle Comeback Club, all the familiar faces were there, except for one man whose spirit will be alive in the hearts and minds of Cardinal fans forever.
On behalf of Mr. Busch and the entire grateful St. Louis Cardinal organization and fans, we proudly present Kenny's familiar number 14 to the wonderful Boyer family.
The Cardinals had some trouble getting untracked in the early months of the 84 season as the frustrations of inconsistency set in. But in early June, the Cardinals decided it was time to let the rest of the league know they had a job to do. McGee's going to catch it. Here's the runner trying to score. The throw home. He is out. He is out on a perfect throw by McGee. A strong defense got the job done all season as the Cardinals committed the fewest errors in the league. But solid defense is a Cardinal trademark, especially at shortstop, where Cardinal fans have seen two of the greatest, Marty Marion and Ozzie Smith. In the 40s, World War II created a sudden loss of talent amongst the baseball world. However, the Cardinals had a brilliant string of success during that era, winning four pennants and three world championships in just a five-year span. From 1942 to 46, the Redbirds ruled baseball's roost, averaging 102 wins a season. They did it with a dominant pitching staff, a powerful batting order, and a defense that had the knack for rising to the occasion. Spearheading that Redbird defense, Mr. Shortstop Marty Marion, nicknamed the Octopus for his long arms and gangly 6'4" frame. During the glorious 40s, Marion was the anchor of the Cardinal defense, but his greatest personal achievement was in 1944, the year that the Browns and the Cardinals played in the only all St. Louis World Series ever.
We played the Browns, the streetcar series here, and that was the year, by the way, that was the year I was named the most valuable player in the league. I like that. I was the first guy in the history of baseball who ever won the most valuable player because he was a good fielder. And that's what I was so proud of.
Marion paved the way for future defensive wizards like Ozzie Smith, a man who makes a living by snatching potential hits and turning them into outstanding outs. The wizard struts his stuff with a little more flair than the great Marion ever did, but the end result remains the same for each and every frustrated opposing hitter.
I think a lot of the things that I do out there in the field are things that I was born with. The ability to dive and so forth and so on. That's not something that I go out and practice all the time, but you have to know who's at the plate hitting, you have to know who's on base running, and what their speed is, you know, so that takes a little studying on your own, you know, to be able to know what you're gonna do with the ball before it's hit either to your left or either to your right.
Ozzie made news off the playing field as well this year, doing his part in bringing the Olympics and baseball closer together. When the Olympic torch made its way through the streets of St. Louis, Ozzie was chosen to carry the honorary flame. Ozzie and his teammates also had some ideas about the Olympic sport they would have liked to participate in.
But I think the one that would fit me most would be gymnastics.
Probably pole vaulting, because I did it in junior high school and I enjoyed it.
I like to be a javelin catcher. I've always thought that if a guy could catch a javelin, he could do anything in the world. So I think if I could catch a javelin, I'd be the greatest athlete in the world.
Well, there are no javelins on the ball field, so Van Slyke tried his hand at the balance bar. And not quite a perfect 10, Andy. Lonnie found it impossible to pole vault, so instead he tried balancing a pole. And the wizard, well, let's just say he's in the freestyle category. Certain players, like Ozzie Smith, are born with a natural ability to rise above others, such as the case with the Cardinals' greatest natural hitter of all time, Stan Musial, a man known simply as Stan the Man.
I got the nickname of Stan the Man by the fans of Brooklyn because the ballpark was so small and I did such great hitting over there that every time I start walking up to the plate, you can hear those fans start whispering, like, here comes that man again, here comes that man again.
Stan, Stan the Man.
In the good old USA, where baseball is the game, many records in the book now have his famous name.
Stanley F. Musial, swinging Stan the Man. He's the man that thrills the fans, swinging Stan the Man.
Every Cardinal batter has lived in the shadow of one of the greatest left-handed hitters of all time. A man whose love for hitting was only surpassed by his affection for his fellow Cardinal teammates. Stan was originally signed out of Denora, Pennsylvania as a pitcher, but an injury forced him into the outfield and later in his career to first base. Musial batted .315 as a rookie in 1942, leading the Cardinals to their first championship since the Gashouse game. It was the first in an amazing 16 consecutive seasons batting over .300. A star among all stars, Stan the Man was selected to the National League squad a record 24 times. Even in All-Star games, he was a clutch performer, especially in 1955 when his 12th inning round-tripper won it. But he was most famous as a classic contact hitter, winning 7 batting championships while rapping out 3,630 hits, the most memorable at Wrigley Field, number 3,000.
That was a curveball, and I was just trying to make the ball. He had 2 strikes on me, and I was just trying to make the ball and get a hit there somewhere.
Musial will be best remembered as the sweet-swinging leader of the Redbird attack for 22 seasons. Since Musial's retirement, 2 intimidating forces have emerged as the leaders of the Redbird mound attack, Bob Gibson and Joaquin Andujar. Gibson's career took flight with the 64 comeback Cardinals, who emerged from 9 games back in mid-August to win the pennant and face the Yankees in the World Series. The heroes of that series, Gibson and Tim McCarver. McCarver had a great series at the plate, batting .478 with 11 hits, the biggest of which was a clutch 3-run homer in the 10th inning of Game 5. The young catcher also had the best view of one of the greatest defensive plays ever in World Series play.
In Game 5, Bob Gibson made the incredible play, and Bob knocked the ball down and threw to first base. And as I said, I'm not sure whether Peppertone was out or safe to this day, but it was a very, very close play. An incredible play on Gibson's part, and I think some of his Harlem Globetrotter training came in very handy when he made that play.
One of the finest all-around athletes ever to play the game, Bob Gibson was baseball's most dominant pitcher throughout the 1960s. That imposing windup and follow-through, unmistakably Gibson's. Yet it was that follow-through that caused him to become vulnerable to a line drive that broke his leg and seemingly the hopes of the 67 Cardinals. But the determined right-hander came back to blow away the Red Sox in the series that season and was unanimously voted the most valuable player. 1968 was his greatest year. A 45-inning scoreless streak ended by a wild pitch and an unbelievable 1.12 earned run average, a modern-day record. Finally, in 1974, it was the culmination of a great career as Gibson became only the second pitcher in history to strike out 3,000. Now, 10 years later in 1984, the Cardinals have another intimidator in Joaquin Andujar, who became the Cardinals' first 20-game winner since Bob Forsch performed the feat in 1977. Andujar had a comeback story of his own in the 82 World Series, as he was hit by a line drive and knocked to the ground and appeared to be finished for the rest of the series. But in Game 7 at Busch Stadium, he came back with a gutsy 7-inning performance and led the Redbirds to their 9th World Championship. Like Gibson, Andujar is a stellar athlete, both defensively and at the plate.
Off the stretch, Deadman. A long run to right field. Way back. Grand slam. Grand slam for Andujar.
There was a lot of excitement in St. Louis during the 84 season as more than 2 million fans came out to root on the Redbirds. All season long, the spirited fans came out to Busch Stadium, just as they have throughout the team's history.
And beginning in 26 and through the Depression, when people needed a cheer around the country, the Cardinals, you see, were the westernmost and, in effect, the southernmost franchise. Therefore, they had a spiritual following that's much larger than the actual area, so I think it became a kind of a national team, almost like the Yankees are.
Cardinal fans have taken a distinct liking to Wheeler dealer Whitey Herzog, the team's manager, whose many deals in 1980 and 81 led to a world championship in 1982. But managing a team is never easy. There are times when you search for an answer to your team's troubles. A time when you look for a guy to step in and turn things around. Whitey found that guy in mid-July, a youngster named Terry Pendleton, who, when inserted into the lineup, instantly sparked the Redbird attack.
He's really turned it around. I started him off hitting six, and he swung the bat real well. I moved him to the third spot. He's been there ever since. And by him being as aggressive as he's been, I think that some of the other guys got a little bit more aggressive.
In only his second week in the big leagues, Pendleton single-handedly led the Cards to a 3-game sweep over the division-leading Mets. Besides his 8 hits in the series, he also sparkled at third base, a relatively new position for him. His inspired play aided in lifting the Redbirds out of their doldrums, and Whitey could be thankful that he had found his lucky star. Finished with a .324 average and could be a star at third base for years to come. Just like Pendleton, another former Cardinal came to the club in the midseason of 1964, Lou Brock, and he proved to be the missing piece in the Cardinal puzzle. The Redbirds were perched in seventh place that year when Brock arrived on the scene. He was an instant hit with St. Louis fans, batting .348 in 103 games. But most of all, he added a new element of speed to the Redbird attack, stealing 33 bases. He served as the catalyst of the Cardinals' championship clubs of the late 60s and had his best series ever in 67 against the Red Sox. He stole a record 7 bases, a record he would equal in the 68 series, while creating general havoc on the base paths for the Boston defense. And in 1977, he reaped the reward for all of those years of running when he replaced Ty Cobb as baseball's all-time stolen base king.
Kreisleben looks. He's going. The pitch is high. The throw is safe. He stole it. The throw got by the shortstop, and Brock has done it.
One of the greatest moments ever in baseball history. Yet there was one more encore ahead, as 50,000 fans paid tribute to a man they had cheered for 16 seasons. In the third inning that night, Brock got hit number 3,000, as he says, finally proving his worth as a hitter as well as a base stealer. He joined Musial as the only Cardinals ever to achieve the feat. Fast feet were always Brock's main weapon, just as it was for the 84 Cards as they topped 200 steals for the third straight time. Past and present, Cardinal runners have always had the urge to break away. Continues to be a Cardinal tradition, just like the tradition of discovering young pitching talent.
We were pitching 3 rookies, and they really did pitch better than we expected them to pitch. We've nursed them along a little bit, and I think that our nucleus of our pitching staff now is somewhat better.
Southpaw Ricky Horton was the first rookie to get rave reviews. He became a starter in mid-June, posted a 9-4 record to go with a 3.44 earned run average. Horton classifies himself as a finesse pitcher and one who relies on a very effective changeup to get out of trouble. His most effective weapon is his pickoff move, one which froze more than one runner in 84.
That's something I've really worked on. It's something that's helped me out a lot over the years. I figure it saves me 2 or 3 games a year and maybe 10 or 12 runs. And you know, that's one less guy that's out there running around the bases that I have to worry about if I'm able to pick him off.
25-year-old Kurt Kepschar won his first Major League start on July 4th and remained in the starting rotation the rest of the season. His back-to-back shutouts over the Cubs and Expos in September brought his overall record to 6-5 and gave Whitey plenty of reason to believe that the powerful right-hander can become a solid starter in the Redbird rotation for years to come. And the last of the young crop, Danny Cox, who in September recorded his first Major League shutout over the Expos.
Swinging a ground ball. Ozzie will have a play at the plate. The throw, perfect. He's out. Great throw by Ozzie Smith, and listen to the crowd.
Now, the young pitchers can't always rely on Ozzie to bail them out. There were 45 times last year when Redbird starters gave way to Bruce Sutter, and he finished things up.
Struck him out. Sutter with the save.
In late September, save number 45 would tie a Major League record and help Joaquin Andujar reach his plateau.
Sutter and the Cardinals and Andujar are one strike away from a lot of good things. And here's his pitch, and he struck him out, and that's the winner. 4-1 Cardinals, number 20 for Andujar, number 45 for Bruce Sutter.
And in acquiring lefty John Tudor from the Pirates in the offseason, the Cardinals have bolstered their starting pitching for 1985. Tudor should fit in nicely, perhaps as the team's number 2 starter. And so, from the early days of 1934 and the antics of the unforgettable Gas House Gang to the 1984 team based on a stirring and relentless spirit, the St. Louis Cardinal teams throughout history have maintained a level of excellence unsurpassed by any other National League team. 13 pennants and 9 world championships.